that we can reach, there absolutely is. I'm 100% sure of that. Are there teachers who have reached this goal? Are there some of us who have reached this goal throughout history? Yes, most definitely, 100% sure of that. Can we do it? Yes, we can. Most important thing we need to do is make great effort, which means to try. Without trying, for sure we won't. We cannot just sit back and rely on luck. It's not a matter of luck. It's a matter of right effort. And the question of what constitutes right effort is very important. But simply, the simple inquiry is key to not intellectually discuss things, but to actually inquire into the situation. Broad strokes, try to find an overall perspective. It is possible. And then try to, from that overall perspective, deepen it and see, continue as much as possible. The ultimate goal is there, and had a glimpse of it. I trust my teachers. They say it's there. They say we can do it. They say we must do it. And what better time to do it than right now? Because we live in very momentous times. We live in, it's like an avalanche is coming down upon the village, really. If we take a step back from a village in high in the Alps, and we could see away up on the mountains a big avalanche is coming down, and we see the people in the village, and they're going with their lives, they're not aware of it. But if we take a step back, we can see the big picture, the mountain, the village, the avalanche coming down. So from that perspective, then we have a different perspective than just those in the village busily going about their, you know, the daily lives without really inquiring at all. The avalanche is coming in this world, so to speak. On the subtle level, the avalanche has already been released. You just have not yet felt this full impact here in the physical density. The subtler densities, a lot has already happened. And intuitively, we kind of feel that. That's why we feel, hey, we really need to be very resolute. Continue on with this feeling of resolute certainty that yes, we can do, yes, we can reach the true goal. And we can even settle into that goal and even remain within the arms, everlasting arms of unconditional love. It is possible. And from time to time, we'll be aware of progress. You know, I'm certainly at time to time aware of progress. Became aware of how we form complexes and how the personality is just this aggregate of complexes. I even had a dream last night that was, I was, almost everything was cleared out and put away and finished. There was just one little wood pile of a couple little pieces of wood, and I said, hey, why are these still here? And then I turned them over and just to see what's there, and I get ready to throw them away, and suddenly I saw this gigantic spider, the biggest spider I've ever seen. And it was pretty amazing, because the spider was different than any I'd ever seen. It was a conglomerate, a complex, a spider complex. It was like a multitude of spiders in one. And this whole multitude of spiders moved as one, like a colony, like a spider colony, all aggregated into this one gigantic spider. And the colors of the spider were amazing, too. It was white with little soft, little flesh colors. It was flesh colors. And I realized this is the aggregate of complexes that together form what we call the flesh. The flesh is really just this aggregate of complexes. And then by exposing it to the light, I didn't kill the spider. I said, no, let's see what it does. And let me just observe it. And it kind of went up on a little wall, little area, and then just kind of stopped there. But it started to shrink. It seemed to be shrinking down less and less and less and less and less. And it lost its scariness. And this falling on the heels of a video in which I was able to talk about complexes, Inquiry into Love, the pre-Olympic 2012 pack, that I saw how complexes form, and we're just this aggregate of complexes, the personality, the persona, the body, the flesh, that whole. And so apparently it's hiding under the bottom of the woodpile, so to speak. I wonder why this is jumping around. Shouldn't be. Hello, sir. Welcome to England, the Olympics. Why is it jumping around like that? I don't know. Should be smooth. Anyway, so at the bottom of the pile, there's only like two pieces left, and I said, what the heck, let's turn them over instead of just like leaving them be. It's very interesting because the whole job was done, and I saw this little pile of wood, and I said, that's weird, that's incongruous, because everything else is completely smooth and immaculately clean and just perfect. And then I saw this little couple of pieces of old grungy looking wood. I said, boy, how come nobody's taking care of that? So that's when I turned them over, and that's when I saw this gigantic spider. Oh boy, I'm telling you, it really set my nerves. But I didn't freak out. Just so at the very bottom of our defenses, we become aware of this aggregate of complexes that is the flesh. And by uncovering that, it's exposed to the light of truth. And in doing so, this aggregate had nowhere to hide anymore. And it sort of put itself in a corner, visible, and it seemed to lose its potency. It's aliveness, you know, its potency. It seemed to lose its potency in it. And I said, just let it be there. It's not bothering me. It's not bothering anybody. I have a tendency not to kill anything. Exceptions would be like a black widow hanging out right there, the hose, where you pick up the hose or something. You know, I said, you know, that's a bad place to hang out. But other than that, try not to kill anything. So the first impulse when you see something like that is oh my gosh, I gotta do something about it. But I didn't. I just so the personality, all this complexes, you don't have to kill it. You don't have to kill the ego. The ego is just the managerial aspect of existence that generates these complexes. Actually, these complexes are generated automatically in existence. Everything in existence is generated automatically, as it were. And the ego, too, is generated automatically as the managerial aspect of existence. And it all simply arises out of fear, out of the desire to be prime creator, to forget what we are, and try and generate some power to become greater than what we are. It's all, everything arises from that. inevitably. Everything is the way that it is, really, inevitably. So, in seeing that spider, I didn't attack it. I just let it be. I think this is the right attitude to have. Very important. Don't attack, don't try to kill the ego, don't try to kill the persona, the personality, the mind, or anything. These complexes, just shine the light of truth and let them be. Let them be. Let it be whatever it wants to be. But the fact is, in the light of unconditional love, all of these complexes are seen as irrelevant. They simply have no relevancy. They don't arise from unconditional love. So they're without a foundation, without a basis to arise. And they're more just seen as this wilted, withered artifact of a previous idea, crazy idea of trying to be prime creator. And they have no potency anymore. They cannot induce any more fear or nervousness in us. Complexes lose their power, their grip. So progress is made on the path. Here's the thing. That complex was not this giant spider of complexes was not uncovered until the very last effort was made, because every time you clean something up, that spider goes down deeper into darkness. It's always looking for darkness, right? So whatever darkness is left, the place where it can hide, it will hide there. So even though you may have thrown away thousands of pieces of wood and debris and cleaned up everything, if there's still a little bit left, that spider's going to be hiding underneath there. And so we might say, well, we've made no progress because all the complexes remain, right? Haven't gotten rid of any of them. You get rid of them all at once, as one, because they all arise from the same source. And when you exchange sources, exchange ideas, they all go together, all the complexes. So you don't need to. The spiritual path is a very wise path. It doesn't focus on individual complexes, this one and this one and this one. No, it says, get to the root of it and you'll find they all come from the very same root. Change the root, they'll go at once. That is the right way. That is the right way. So you might have worked a long time and still have all these complexes because there may be just a little tiny hiding place still left. And when you finally overturn that last stone, that last piece of chopped wood, and then the spider's got nowhere else to hide in it. It starts going out into the open. And you're like, what a terrible-looking thing it is. It's the flesh. You know, it's the flesh. The flesh is horrible. We love beautiful people because the flesh is so ugly and so horrible that anyone who doesn't look ghastly, we just want to cling to them and say, oh, what a relief to, you know, what a relief to see something that isn't so terribly ugly. It's not that it's beautiful in itself. It's simply relatively less hideous. I mean, beautiful bodies seem to be relatively less hideous. Even though if we imagine what they're going to look like in 50 years, then we'd run shrieking and screaming away, you know. Oh, God, no. Yeah, horrible. Flesh is absolutely horrible. So, you know, seeing this flesh, this complexes of flesh are just yuck. But somehow my nerves held, you know, I don't know how. Well, all those years of inquiry. Saw another dream. It's a pretty amazing dream. Wow, amazing stuff is going on now in the world. The subtle level and in this cornfield, all the corn was wrapped up very tight. Every corn plant was somehow bundled very tightly with the corn pressed very tightly, and it was very something really, really heavy is with us. We know there's a tremendous drought around the world right now. I also had somebody whispering in my ear, and I finally turned to someone and I told them, you know, what are you talking about? A bunch of gibberish you're talking about. And then I noticed who it was, and then I noticed they had a website and they had a huge amount of information on the world and what's to come. And they were whispering about the Ukraine. You know, I said, why are you whispering these things? I said, I don't know. I do know that the Ukraine went through a terrible famine after World War II, I believe it was. I wonder if the world is heading towards famine. If we have enough severe droughts, the weather's becoming very severe. The ice cap in Greenland is suddenly, you know, starting to melt. Big, huge glaciers are breaking off, and the world is in transit. It's in transition. It's in transition time, more than we're aware of. And by all means, it's so important to maintain right effort and inquiry, no matter what. No matter what success seems to come or not, because I'm telling you here that success is deferred and delayed on the spiritual path until the very end, is what I'm seeing. Because I can say that in spite of all my efforts, I don't feel like I've really made any significant progress at all. Because the aggregate of complexes, I'm aware of them, but they're still there. You see, they're still there. And again, the secret I've seen is they leave all at once. That is the whole secret of the path, is to realize that you cannot have such a thing as a partial loss compared to no loss. If there's such a thing as no loss, then you cannot categorize a partial loss as no loss. If there are absolutes, you cannot say that something relative is an absolute, is the same. You cannot. In reality is an absolute. There is no loss at all in reality. There's no death at all. There is no sickness. There is no fear. See, none. It's an absolute. It is absolutely the way that it is. So we struggle with that very badly. And because of the ego and our objective to be prime creator, this generates enormous trouble, where we try to believe that half-truths are partially true. No, half-truth is not partially true. It's completely false. Okay? And so these areas, I've been able to, you know, see everything this way. And yet, again, the complexes that arise from existence, automatically, when you come into this world, these complexes simply begin to build up around you, so to speak, and within you, automatically. And so they're still there. They're still there. So from my standpoint, I say, well, you know, they're still there. I must have not really made any significant progress. But then again, if they all leave at once, and if I'm very close to that happening, then you'd have to say that significant progress has been made. So it's really very dangerous to judge where you are on a spiritual path because of this. You're liable to fall into despair. In fact, almost any judgment of your spiritual path, you're going to fall into despair, because you're going to realize, you're going to know you still have these complexes. And you think, wow, I haven't gotten anywhere. Whereas you think other people are freeing themselves from these complexes. No. There's all sorts of therapy that can shuffle the complexes, that can morph them, that can play with them, that can do stuff. But they are continuously being generated in existence. Who's this? I don't know who this is. So even no matter what kind of therapy you have in existence. I don't know, they just went on their way. It doesn't really get anywhere. It's just a shuffling of the deck. The real goal is to have all complexes leave simultaneously at the same time. Because to see that they're all one, there's no difference between any of them, really. And this is the success. So up until that point, it's going to seem like you have not had really good success for everybody. I think everyone's in that same boat. Some people develop complexes of success and then think they've succeeded because they have a success complex. You know, there's all sorts of complexes that can be generated in existence, but what we're looking for is to have them all go at once, because they're seen as irrelevant. In regard to unconditional love, they're irrelevant. So that's the absolute that you are have now chosen. You choose that absolute of unconditional love, and from that standpoint, you view existence from that standpoint. Not from a double standpoint. Not from unconditional love and conditional love. No, only from unconditional love. And that, from there, these complexes have no relevancy. And so they just dwindle, dissipate, shrink, deflate into, like, you know, when a spider sheds its skin somehow, sometimes you see insects, they are shedding, and it's just the husk of their previous body there. It's the husk. And you might look at it and go, oh, startled, and then look and see, oh, there's nothing there. It's just the fragile, thin husk that's been shed, you know. It's like that. So you might be able to look and say, well, at one point, there used to be complexes there, but there's no complexes there anymore. So again, the difficulty that anyone has on the spiritual path is simply that it's success deferred to the very end point. Any teacher has a difficult time, because those who come for advice and encouragement, they're going to feel like, well, you know, I haven't got it yet. And, you know, after so much effort, they'll say, I still don't have it. And they're going to lose their patience and get frustrated, for sure. The success is deferred till the very end, when you have to unturn that final stone. But all the effort has been to get you to the point where you can overturn that final stone, where you're not frightened, where you say, well, I don't think I want to bother with that one. You know, it's good enough, because deep down we know there's something hiding there. Hey. Whew. The complexes, they're many, multitudinous. It's ugly, yuck. It's not beautiful. It's bumpy. It's a mess, you know. Our personas are a mess. They really are a mess. So many people try to beautify their external appearance, you know, trying to cover up the mess of their complexes that form their personality and persona. Just horrible. In fact, most people in this world are very astute at that. We all do it, because inside we know we're not beautiful as far as the complexes go. But once the complexes leave, it's kind of like you can look out and you just feel like, wow, there's no complexes anywhere. There's no ugliness anywhere anymore. It's all gone. It's all gone. And that's the great goal that we're aiming for. And the greatest that anyone can do on the path is simply to not give up. And to not settle for any success complex. Don't rest on your laurels, because you will know when you finally succeed, because again, no ugliness anywhere, just complete, serene beauty and calmness, and it's just perfection. You know, there's no complexes anywhere. So don't settle for a success complex, which it's tempting. It's very tempting. It doesn't really get you anywhere. It just causes worse problems, worse delays, which is why it's very helpful to have what's called a satguru, or a great guru, a great teacher, where you can just compare anything you come across with this satguru, with this great guru, and then you realize, no, this is not it. It's not the end. You say, okay, gotta keep working. It's extremely helpful. Extremely helpful to have a satguru. I have three of them. Jesus Christ, especially through his work that was recorded in the Bible, through his work recorded in A Course in Miracles, and through the work that many of his followers throughout history have done also. And then you have Anandamayi Maha in India, 1896 to 1982, and Ramana Maharshi, who I think he passed away in 1950 something, 6 or 7. Those are three satgurus. We also have others in history too. And a satguru, with the last two, Anandamayi Maha and Ramana Maharshi, you have pictures, you have videos, you have people who have met them that talk about having met them, and I've come in contact with people who met them, and you know, you have a very good sense, you know, that this is completely legitimate. And so they're like the touchstone in anything that we come across in this world in terms of success, spiritual success. I compare it. Like, I compare it to those sadgurus. And then evaluate from that standpoint. And then what happens is I say, well, I've got to keep, you know, got to keep going. And finish the job. Uncover every stone, turn every stone, because that last stone, that's the one that's hiding the whole shebang. And and it's really a question of getting nerves ready for it. To have the complexes of existence, to have them uncovered all at once. You see, we try to do it bit by bit because we're scared, but that gets us nowhere. Waste time. This is very interesting. You have to trust in that by building up your nerve through inquiry, you do have the nerve to drop it all at once. By thinking that you can never have enough nerve to drop it all at once, you then end up trying to struggle with one complex here and one complex over there, and you spend your life in therapy, as it were, and, you know, you end up with just as many complexes or more than you started, maybe in worse condition. And you don't have the nerve, you haven't built up the nerve to let them all go at once. And you've just gotten nowhere, really. Tilting at windmills Of course I know those who have gone, the testimony of those who have been through lifelong therapy. I mean, therapy used to be all the rage. I mean, it was the thing to do, especially among the upper classes, those who could afford it. I mean, they were people been in therapy 20, 30 years. Some of them their whole lives. And, you know, so we have accounts of all of this. And it's not the same. Spiritual path assures you that through clarity and inquiry, you can get to the point where you're able to withstand seeing all the complexes leave at once, one time, which I did in this dream. And all leaving at once, you are free. You are free. You're really free. And you're finished with the path. Finished with inquiry, finished with the path, finished with complexes, and you are now aware of unconditional love. And so that path is the path of success. And so that is what I continually talk about, is if you're on the spiritual path, keep going. If you're on the path of inquiry, keep going. Don't worry about therapy for some problem. Okay, that's not it. I tried that path, actually. When these complexes of existence started to generate. Initially, I came in here not to pull in any complexes, but because the world simply rejected the all or nothing, 100%, you know, truth or lies type of thing, I said, well, I better try and meet him halfway. And then in doing that, pulled in all these complexes and suffered from them terribly. And then the mode of the world to treat this is therapy. And then you're supposed to, you know, try and look at particular details in a particular complex, isolate it, dissect it, and all this stuff. Didn't work at all, did nothing. And then I was fortunate enough to get on the spiritual path, full blast. And again, all the complexes are still here. There's been no change in my personality. Okay, that's something very important. No change. Complexes are the same. But I've gotten to the point where I'm able to see them all leave at once, which is the only cure there is. Because they're all equally the same. They're all equally nothing, all equally futile, all coming from the very same source, serving the very same purpose. And I don't want that purpose anymore. I don't want that idea of being prime creator anymore. I don't want the purpose that it serves. I don't want the delusion, the illusion, the mirage, the fear, the confusion, the complexity, all of that stuff. I don't want it anymore. So in deciding to serve a different purpose, these complexes have no utility. None, no utility. So they're free to go. They're free to go. Let them go. And again, I'm not going to try and capture it and dissect it and make a report on all these complexes. That's what someone who believes in a therapy would do. Let's say, let's get it in a laboratory bottle and let's dissect it under the microscope and let's parse it all out and map it out and all this kind of stuff. No, that's absolutely the wrong approach. The right approach is simply to say, as long as I wanted the purpose that these complexes serve, they're going to be with me. When I change the purpose that I want, they're going to depart from me. What more needs to be taught than that? Nothing. So again, therapy from one standpoint is futile because it's not changing the purpose of what we really want. Because we either want truth or lies. We either want the what is or what's impossible. We either want everything or nothing. It's very cut and dried. And so we simply, by changing the purpose of what we want, then we only get what serves that purpose. And what doesn't serve that purpose is going to depart from us. It's very simple. Very simple. So the departing of those complexes, it was startling. You know, initially, it was very startling initially. But to tell you the truth, the size of the spider actually shrank immediately. When I first saw it, it was enormous. I jumped back and said, "Ah, my God, what a biggest spider I've ever seen," you know. And then, but right away, as it started walking, you know, scurrying away from me, it got smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, and my fear dissipated very quickly, very quickly. So I really didn't have a flood of fear, as it were, that dissipated fast. There was no hysteria built up, none. What we really fear in a fear is hysteria setting in. I experienced that one time when I had this dream of total chaos, hysteria set in. I had the dream, when I had the dream of seeing the destruction of this planet, really, the problems that are going to come here, the devastation on the physical density here on this planet, I got hysterical. Fear simply, everywhere, there's no way to stop it, you know. But in this case, there was no hysteria. Hysteria is terrible. It is terrible. Because you can't find anything within you to stop it. And you feel like it's going to continue forever. And then that just makes it worse. So I guess when I looked at this world and devastated world, I thought this is going to be this way forever. It's ruined. Our home is ruined. It's terrible. And it generated this hysteria. Whereas in this case, there was no hysteria at all. None. Just a kind of startled, initially startled. Like, whoa, that's an ugly looking monster. Really. Their personality is really like a monster. It really is. Horrible monster. Let me boost this up a little bit. So it's not a joke. It's not a joke. The spiritual path is one of continually inquiring deeper and deeper and deeper, and so you can look and see the absolute choice that is actually there, and get more and more your nerves more and more accustomed to it, familiar with it, so that even though you might startle, you quickly recover. For instance, even now, like when I'm working in the yard or something and there's like a spider there, I'll kind of startle for a second. But immediately, it's gone. Just, oh, okay. It's just sort of a reaction. If we're walking along and we think we see a snake, we're going to go, we're going to kind of jump just momentarily. Then we see it's a stick. We go, just keep walking. It's not a problem. It's kind of like that. It's kind of like there's a startle reflex. And I'm just looking at, remembering the dream and looking at this spider. Don't really need to look at it. That's the key, really. I mean, it's not important because it's departing. It's departing, not to come again. So, again, what need is there to look at it? The important thing is that it's all departing at once. That is the important thing. It's not what is departing, like how many complexes are departing. Is it 122, 123, 300? How big are they? How are they juxtaposed to one another? All that stuff is a fool's accounting. The important facet of this all this is that it's departing all at once, and it's quickly diminishing and shrinking. And it's not coming after you. No, it wasn't coming after me. It was departing in a hurry. It didn't want any part of me, that's for sure. Let it go in peace, because it served our purpose well. Our purpose to dwell in a scenario of loss, so that we could be in forgetfulness of what we are, so that we could pretend that we could be something greater than we are. It served that purpose. It's fear. All of that is fear-based. Fear of loss. The fear of loss generates all these complexes. The fear of abandonment, the fear of scarcity, fear of attack, fear of vulnerability, fear of confusion, fear, so many fears, all come from just one root. The desire to be prime creator, to change what we are, change reality. That necessitates the arising of this vast loss-based scenario, this scenario of loss. Everything is vulnerable to loss, everything. And within that, we try to spin this scenario to maintain it, so we don't just throw it down immediately. And we try to spin it in through all these complexes that eventually they all build up. And we get, you know, here we are with a body, a human body, and we're desperately trying to maintain interest in this scenario. Like a human body aggregate complex is like a very advanced way of trying to maintain interest in this scenario of loss. Very advanced way. We're capable, human bodies capable of developing all sorts of distractions and defenses and activities that seem to give false hope. And so it's just existence has gradually built up more and more ways, sophisticated ways to try and maintain allegiance and loyalty to this whole scenario of loss. And to we do that through false hope, believing that there will be a way, somehow this loss will turn into having more than everything. We will be greater than everything. We'll have more than everything. We will be the new prime creators and be a new creation of our own. And we believe that somehow it's going to result in that magically. Of course, it never will. But we're very clever at generating all sorts of false hope. Humans, very clever. But the problem is the effort to generate all that falsity and false hope, all those complexes, that causes severe suffering at the same time. Like you look at a cat, the cat is not suffering from too many complexes. They have complexes, definitely. Animals certainly have complexes. Well, they suffer to a certain extent. The more advanced you become, the worse the suffering gets. And when you are a very clever, smart, capable human, you can gather so many complexes, get gathered around that it you feel absolutely trapped and in horrendous suffering. And then from that point, you say, wow, wait a minute. I need to ask what purpose these complexes are serving. Because this, you know, unless they're serving some incredible just cause, just purpose, I don't want them. That's the feeling. I don't want them. And then from that standpoint, inquiry begins. That's what happens. The suffering gets so terrible as you try to generate false hope for everybody. That's what I was called upon to do, you know, in previous life, and then starting out this life, and because people didn't respond, I thought, well, I better find a way to make them happy so that generate a lot of false hope that, hey, we can solve problems of this world. Yes, we can bring peace here. Yes, we can have beauty, and we can love this place. We can learn to love it and all this. We can learn to love loss, living in a loss-based scenario. And that just pulled in so many complexes that I couldn't even function anymore. That's what happens. And then you have to inquire, say, wow, is it worth it? And when you start inquiry, you start to see stuff you never saw before. Because you're not trying to maximize your functioning through this complex anymore. You're simply asking about the purpose that they serve. See, it's a difference. Big difference. The spiritual path is inquiry about purpose. What's the purpose that existence serves? And can we serve a different purpose? Is the question. And in looking at it that way, you get a different perspective. And you don't feel quite at the mercy of all these complexes, because you say, wait a minute, I haven't yet determined if the purpose these are serving is a just right purpose or not yet. So I'm going to keep on considering this instead of being impelled by these complexes to function the way they want you to function. You know, you get someone like Elvis Presley or something who was impelled to put on the song and dance for the world. He just couldn't stop it, even though it was killing him. Because these complexes just absolutely impel you to do more and more and more to try and make everyone happy here. So Elvis, you know, he tried to pull away from it, but he wasn't able to. Very scary thing. Very scary. The more talent you have, the more you gather these complexes, and they try to impel you to produce happiness in the world. And of course, it's not possible. So you push yourself more and more and more, and you take more and more drugs to try and keep yourself upright. And eventually you collapse. Eventually collapse. So I collapsed just from the weight of the complexes. The complexes are so heavy I couldn't even function. And so at that point, since I couldn't, the effort to impel myself out in the world didn't work anymore, because my health completely collapsed from the pressure of it. And I wanted to, like, produce music that would fill the entire world with this incredible, beautiful music and reach everybody in the world, and had to be way better than anything that's ever come before. And all it's just, you know, the complexes were impelling, you know, too much, so much that my nervous system just, you know, was over-revved entirely. And then from that point, since I couldn't really go out there and be another Elvis or something, you know, some real inspirational source of great inspiration as for happiness in the world, all I could do is I questioned the purpose. Say, wait a minute. I have all these complexes. They're trying to impel me. I can't do it. What's going on? You know, it's kind of crazy. And then I started questioning the purpose that these complexes served, because I had a memory of reality. I wasn't far removed from awareness of truth. And I said, you know, I'm not sure that these complexes are serving truth. I'm not sure about it. Let me, you know. And then that began the inquiry. And then gradually you see how stark it is. It's all or nothing. It's either 100% or you have 0%. You either serve truth or you serve lies. You either serve life or you serve death. You either serve nothing or you serve everything. That's why Jesus said, you're for me or against me. Very profound statement, which is 100% true, which is all truth is 100% true. You either serve truth or you don't serve truth. You serve lies, which are disguised as half-truths, which the world is becoming very adept at and embracing during these times, unfortunately. We live in a time where half-truths are being elevated to the high fashion, and an inquisitional mindset in the world and a witch hunt attitude, witch hunt inquisitional attitude from the half-truths, from a lack of understanding, a lack of inquiry. And the world's headed for really disaster. Because the foundation has been termited. There has been a foundation of at least subliminal awareness that we have a responsibility here to truth, to awaken to truth, to choose truth, to change our purpose, to change our purpose. We have, it's been that subliminal awareness, and now that's been termited to the point where so many now cannot even locate that. It's so buried within, so deeply buried, that they cannot even reach that. Okay, just one second. I can take this. There you go. Okay. That's how you have to handle it. I forgot to put the phone on, take the ring off. So we can do that. We can take a break. We don't have to just go nonstop. I'm just giving sort of an overview, looking back in hindsight, of what went right. That actually suffering, great suffering in this world is the highest benefit, because it comes from being overwhelmed with too many complexes which are trying to get you to be a superstar, and it's without mercy. It just piles on, and eventually you can't function anymore, and you suffer so terrible, then you have to inquire about purpose. And when you inquire about purpose, you start to find out answers. You know, you say, wait just a minute here. You're talking to the complex. You say, wait just a minute. I'm not so sure about all this. I'm not so sure I'm supposed to be bringing happiness to the world in the way that you think. I'm not so sure I'm supposed to be bringing world peace. There's something doesn't fit. There's something wrong here. I'm gonna dig deeper. I'm gonna clean things up more. I'm gonna really take a careful look here. And the more careful you look, the more you want to look. And you keep inquiring and inquiring and inquiring. So if you happen to be someone who's suffering and feel like you just are so burdened by complexes, you can't move those out. You can't even move yourself out in the world. You can't even project yourself in the world. You have the supreme opportunity that existence gives, which is inquiry into purpose. And then eventually, in inquiring into purpose, you come to a point where it no longer freaks out to let go, change purposes. And with that change of purpose, the complexes go. And then you don't need to project yourself out in the world, because you are already one with the world. You're already completely there, everywhere, so to speak. Because unconditional love is already everywhere. And that is what you're experiencing. So your experience is already out there. Not a problem. It's not, it doesn't generate a complex about itself. Unconditional love doesn't generate complexes at all. So you remain this, you know, pristine. So there really have been those who have gotten there. It's inevitable. It is inevitable in existence that you will get there. Because existence has to generate these complexes, defense mechanisms, and it cannot stop. It's never enough, because you're continuously getting bored and want to change your purpose. So it has to keep building up more and more complexity of complexes, and eventually it gets to be too much. Inevitably. And at that point, you literally cannot project yourself in the world. You feel like a complete failure, and there's nowhere to go, nothing to do, and you just say, well, wait a minute, you know, am I sure that this is all the way it's supposed to be? And what is the purpose anyway? You know, remind me. And you find out that the ego can't remind you, cannot tell you what the purpose of existence is. You begin to realize through your own tremendous desire to clarify that the ego has no interest in clarifying anything, and is a liar, and it doesn't really cooperate with you. It doesn't cooperate with the investigation. In fact, it tries to stonewall the investigation. It does everything but cooperate. And so that brings about feeling like, hey, you know, the ego, just, there's something wrong with the ego here. There's something isn't right at all. Something's very fishy. Smells very rotten. And I'm not sure what it is, but I can smell it. You know how when you're somewhere and you smell something rotten and you mention it to somebody, and maybe somebody will say, look around, they'll see, nah, I don't see anything. I don't see anything that's rotten. But your nose knows there's something rotten, right? You just haven't found what it is yet. But it's amazing how people will simply dismiss this. They say, well, what do you think it is? And then you say, well, I don't know. And they'll just say, oh, you know, well, you know, I don't think there's anything rotten here. And here, if you have a good nose, you know there's something rotten, because it's, poof, you know, it's in the air and you smell it. It's like that, you know. That within your scenario of what you see to be yourself, something's rotten. Something doesn't add up at all. And you know, it stinks. And you feel like you've got to get to the bottom of this. Where's it coming from? Where's the stagnation coming from? This horrible, stagnant smell and feeling. Where's it coming from? And where's this overburdened feeling coming from? What's generating this? You know, it's the ego. The ego has to ceaselessly manage existence. And in that management, it has to do the things that it does and build up these complexes. It cannot avoid it. No, it's impossible to avoid that. If you're serving the purpose, if you want to serve the purpose of existence, if you believe existence will give you what you want, you then have to be managed by the ego. There's no other way. And the ego will overmanage. It will get in its own way. It will build up these complexes. And I know we hate these complexes, and we spend all this effort, you know, to try and figure out how can we, you know, prevent these complexes from building up. That's the wrong question. The question is, why are they building up in the first place? What's giving rise to them? And what purpose do they serve? So what we're trying to do is we're trying to keep the same purpose of trying to be prime creator, forget what we are, be in this loss-based scenario, and yet somehow manage to not have complexes arise. You know, that's the goal that the ego holds out to us. Have your cake and eat it too. And it's an impossible goal. And you'll develop massive complexes around attempting to do this. You know, utopianists have the worst complexes, have severe complexes, dangerous complexes, really. Because they've got into the complex of success. This complex of success, like, yes, we can do this. We can build this utopia. There's a way. This becomes a severe complex, but they're able to still get out there and be very energetic about it. But the more compassion has, the greater the amount of complexes will come in, because it senses that you have more willingness to help. Greater and greater willingness. So the greater the willingness to help, the more complexes come in, to the point where you can't function. You don't have any energy. Just feeding these complexes takes all your energy. It's unbelievable. And the more honest you are, the more compassionate, etc., just in order to maintain the purpose of trying to make existence, to heal existence, etc., it requires enormous complexes to just build up, like, gigantic. And then you can't function, which is a great thing, because then you go into inquiry. There's nothing else to do. Nothing else to do. And then you start building up your nerve. And you are able to take the path the right way. Instead of trying to heal the world, you're trying to exchange the purpose that the world serves for a different purpose. Instead of trying to fix what's broken, you choose a purpose to experience what can never be broken. Instead of trying to learn to love us, you decide to love non-loss. Instead of trying to get used to death, you decide to choose life. Instead of trying to heal sickness, you decide to use flawless refreshment. Flawless freshness and refreshment, constant freshness. Instead of trying to get used to conflict, you choose perfect peace. And on and on and on, on and on and on and on. You can use almost endless examples here. Instead of trying to make a loss your home, to be at home in loss, you decide to be in home in no loss. Instead of trying to get used to vulnerability, you decide to choose invulnerability. Here comes a bird hopping up the path. like that. So it's a different path. You realize you can't have truth and lies can't both be true. You have to choose one or the other, which you serve. You have to ask yourself what you want to serve. Because whatever you want, you will experience the purpose that serves what you want. So when we see this world, it's serving a purpose that we think we want, and that is actually to be prime creators. But we can't be prime creators, so that what we want then gets shunted off to loss. I mean, we want to maintain this experience, you know. Why? Because we want it to pay off eventually. We want it to pay off. But it never will. You know, I think that nest with all those birds in it, baby birds, they're all gone. They're all gone. It's been quiet for several days now. They left. Interesting. Yeah. Just like that. Wow. I didn't even aware, was not really much aware of it. I just sort of haven't heard them for a while. And now I realize that, no, they've gone. Just like that. And now it's quiet. Just like the complexes will go at some point when you decide you really want a different purpose. And then you only want that purpose because you realize it's either that or something else. And it's either reality or a dream of loss. That's it. There isn't any other option. We keep thinking there's some other option. There's not. There is no other option. Bringing this into focus then really, really, really helps. But it doesn't always stay in focus. Which is why periods of inquiry, satsang, are super helpful. To bring it into focus. To have those times when you bring it into focus. Because the rest of the time it's going to get diffuse again. And it will just kind of be a vague intellectual concept. You won't really see it. So right now, like for instance, what am I inquiring about? Well, I'm inquiring about whether it's really important to focus on complexes leaving, or should it just actually not even important to even pay any attention to it. Irrelevant. How they leave, how fast they leave, all of that is very irrelevant. So I'm inquiring into just how important it is to assess the leaving of the complexes. And maybe I'm saying, well, maybe it's, for instance, like an inquiry, I'll go, okay, let's say, I'll take both sides. First, I'll say, let's say it's very, very important. And then I'll say, why is it very important? And, you know, ask questions of it. And then I'll switch over and I'll say, let's say it's not important at all. It's very unimportant. And then I'll dig into that and see why would somebody take that position? So inquiry is like that. It's like you're sort of like a neutral judge, and you're investigating this, and you have a case before you, and you want to get to the bottom of it and find the truth of the situation. So you call up each side and say, okay, present your case to me, I want to hear it. And then you ask questions of them to get clarified. Then you call up the other and ask questions of that, and then maybe you get a feeling of which way you're going to judge on this particular. And then so you call up the other and say, give me some more clarity on it. It's like that. Which is why this whole attitude of polarization in the world is just ruinous. When I say the world is headed in a ruinous direction, I truly believe that. 100% believe that. Because having done so much inquiry, I know what it takes. And I know that the attitudes in the world are contrary to what it takes in inquiry. It's leading people away from inquiry. People are just disputing with one another. That is not the spirit of inquiry. The spirit of inquiry is to have a very calm courtroom, so to speak. And you welcome everyone in peace and love and the spirit of getting truth. And then you simply ask questions here, ask questions there. You run a distant courtroom. You don't want to have any outbursts. And you are fair to this side. You're fair to hear this. You're fair. You know. And of course, the ego is always screaming that you're not fair because you're not giving it more time. The ego thinks that if you just give it unlimited time, it will come up with the answer. And it thinks that you're not appreciating its point of view because you haven't given enough time. So if you give the ego like 4 hours to respond to something, and then you say, wow, you know, that doesn't quite add up. The ego will insist that if you give it 4 more hours, you will see the beauty of what it's saying. It's just you haven't given it enough time. So it tries to monopolize the proceedings of inquiry. So with inquiry, you have to say, no, ego, you've had 4 hours. Now let me give 4 hours to the Holy Spirit here. You know, let me hear voice of reason. Let me listen to the voice of reason, present its case. You've had your say. Let me hear this say. And the ego says, no. Because the ego knows it's full. Its case is weak. It's fragile. It's really nothing. It's built on bluff. And so it doesn't want equal time at all. So in this world now, we're in a situation where people simply want to monopolize their point of view entirely. This party, that party, this agenda, that agenda, they don't want to give equal time of actual consideration of what are the merits, what are the weighing, what are the merits, what are the reasonable merits of this. No, they're only looking to tear down someone else, attack someone else, and to prevent inquiry from taking place. It's absolutely shocking. Now, one thing I can say about therapists and therapy is that they used to be this way. I don't know if it still is, but probably to some extent, is that they do have this spirit of let's look together and weigh things. And that's a type of inquiry. It's just that their discipline is not properly grounded on the right foundation of realizing all complexes have to leave simultaneously. But there is some merit to therapy in that one, there is inquiry there. Good therapists will simply enable inquiry, and there are some spiritual therapists in the world who are facilitating a spirit of inquiry. Okay, I don't know if they've reached the point where all their complexes disappeared or not, and if that is a stable condition or not. That's something that only God only knows. But they do facilitate a spirit of inquiry to some extent. Some try to push it a little too fast to a conclusion of simply short-circuiting inquiry and getting to saying, look, who's asking all these questions anyway? Let's just short-circuit the whole thing. But really, I believe as a final step, maybe that's appropriate. Excuse me. It's an airplane. These ways of just boom, you know, just drop it, those evolve out of a long tradition of inquiry, like in India, for instance, Advaita Vedanta in non-dual teachings, largely evolved out of Asia and India, and those traditions where there's a long, vast culture of inquiry. So the idea is that, now, Westerners, we're in a hurry. You know, we want fast food. So we just say, okay, what's the final step? And they say, well, who's asking all these questions? And so we grab a hold of the final step and think, we can just get all this final step, boom, fast food. We've gone into the drive-in window. We've ordered our burger and fries and shake, and we're off down the road. You know, we're good to go. And it just doesn't work that way at all. Because one has to, through inquiry, change what one wants, really decide that what the ego is offering is really nothing and will never work. And to have tremendous grounding and stability and clarity before one can handle seeing all the complexes leave at once. Because those complexes have served the purpose that we've been wanting for so long, to see them all leave at once without truly being willing to change the purpose that you what you want, and seeing that it is a genuine change, that takes enormous inquiry and clarity over a lot of time and effort. So you cannot simply go from a state of embracing the purpose of existence and what it serves, and then walk into a satsang and say, you know what, I want to bring happiness to the world, so can you enlighten me? And the teacher says, well, who's asking the question? Who's this I? Is there any I? If you can't find any I, then there you go. You know, that's it. You've done it. You just can't, you can't do that. It doesn't work that way. Because to see all those complexes which have served the purpose of existence, trying to heal the world, make it beautiful, bring beauty and peace and love and harmony and comfort and all this stuff, to try to make this loss-based scenario feel like something we really want to hold on to, all those complexes serve that purpose, as well as many others too, which aren't so wonderful, very destructive purposes, which, you know, the other side of the coin, we refuse to look at that. So to see all those complexes just going away, you would feel as if you had no more capacity to get what you want, which then would feel absolute devastation, terrible devastation. And you would just, you know, wouldn't be able to sleep, you would just be freaked out. Because you'd feel like, I have no capability to get what I want, and never will. So that would just cause us, you know, very severe reaction. So you cannot get, there is no fast food spirituality. There is none. We, in the West, we are so into marketing and advertising and efficiency, and you know, fast, that we have a culture of believing in ingenuity and cleverness and inventiveness to such an extent that we really only look to for the magic pill, for that one-stop, all-in-one shopping experience, for that one retreat. You know, let's go to one retreat and I'm going to get it done right then and there, and that's it. And we feel like our identity is so tied up in that we refuse to even entertain any other way. It's that or nothing else. Because we feel inferior if we can't do it fast. So the idea of spending a lifetime in inquiry to the point where you really succeed is to us a complete anathema. I mean, nobody's going to do that, really. I might have to take another break here. Another arrival. Just won't do it. We feel inferior. We feel like we're somehow betraying the purpose of our being here. Because the purpose of our being here, the purpose we're serving, is to try and make it seem like it is, existence can be easy. It's almost like we say, well, enlightenment is so easy, don't worry, we can get it anytime we want. Just you know, go in and boom. So, you know, take it or leave it. What's the hurry? If I need it, I can always go get it. In the meantime, let's, you know, go fix the world. It's kind of like that. The ego is very tricky. In believing in this, you know, quick, easy enlightenment, the ego is essentially saying, why worry about it? Why even make efforts toward it? It's pretty simple, easy, quick anyway, so what's the big deal? Okay, 1 minute. We'll take another meditative break. there again when there's a little episode of interaction. You just let it happen and go right back to it. It's easy. I'm talking about the Western way that we have been conned into this belief that, you know, sudden enlightenment, that's a con. It's not true. We've misinterpreted all complexes leading us as there's some kind of sudden enlightenment. Well, it may have taken you 30, 40 years of intense effort to get to the point where you're able to allow this to happen. That's not sudden. 40 years is not sudden. Just because it all leaves at once at the end doesn't mean that the path that you've taken is sudden. It's all one path that's taken all this time. It's the opposite of sudden. And so what's happened is the Western mentality of advertisement and marketing, etc., thinks that they can just market it in such a way that we'll just say, yeah, because we're so used to being able to market things to people, to us, to the world, movies, television, products, all types, cars, machinery, medicines of all types. All these products, we have been geniuses, the Western world, at marketing those throughout the whole world, and other parts of the world are getting very good at it too. And so we're used to being able to manipulate what people want through advertising. And we think we've developed a science of advertising, and that we're able to really very, very accurately manipulate what people want and get them to buy certain products. In other words, to change their mind or to shape their mind, shape their choice through advertising and marketing and subtle influence, etc. So we simply applied that mindset to the spirituality of the East and the traditions of the West, the ancient traditions of the West. The modern age has simply applied the marketing. Modern age is all about marketing and packaging, etc., which is part of marketing. And we simply felt we could apply this. So we say, what can we do? Let's see if we apply this, what happens. And so we think we can merely, through the right kind of marketing, get people to change what they want. Decide to just choose. Say, oh, okay, I was choosing this, but now I want this. Okay. Huge, 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 huge mistake. Tragic, tragic, tragic mistake, which is why I absolutely know that you have to severely limit marketing and advertising and all of that in any world, in any culture that wants to be serious about inquiry in the spiritual path. Because we now have first-hand experience on this, big time. And wisdom cultures do limit it. They do not allow the physical form to be used generally in any sort of way, depicted in any sort of way. They certainly don't allow in any advertising. They don't allow advertising hardly at all, or marketing of stuff, and because it leads to of trouble. It leads to the ego simply running wild. If, for instance, the ego will say, hey, just go out and do everything I want you to do and don't worry about it, because I'll send you to some retreat with some guru and anytime, and you'll get it. This guru's top notch. And they assure me that 1 week with them and you'll be enlightened. So then you're thinking, oh, okay, no, I can go work on all these projects and do all this stuff that is going to, what the ego wants me to do, to heal the world, to help the world, etc. And once I get in all these complexes start building up, et cetera, and I'm all messed up and on drugs and living a wild, crazy lifestyle, and no problem. I can just go to the guru, go to this retreat for a week, and I'll be enlightened. I'm not losing any opportunity here. I'm not wasting my time. That's what it leads to. That is what it leads to. That is why you have so many people in terrible shape in this world now. It's a disaster. It's a disaster. And I was supremely fortunate in that I was unable to function in the world. And so all I could do was inquiry, whether I wanted to or not. It's all I could do. And then I did enough of it, so I realized, wow, this will really eventually succeed. And I got enough support along the way where I kept at it. So I didn't waste my time thinking that wasting my time not doing inquiry, thinking that all I needed was a weekend retreat or a week retreat with some guru. Because I always said, no. I don't think that's going to work. Plus, I didn't have any money to do it anyway, which is good. So I'm grateful that these gurus charge so much money for their retreats because that kept me from going there. I'm grateful that they charge so much money to go see them because I couldn't afford it. So I didn't do it. And so I just continued with my inquiry because I wasn't expecting some guru to solve the problem in a, you know, boom, like that. It's like, either I do the inquiry or I'm going to continue to suffer. Those are the only options I've had. So that's, I'm talking about what works, what's helpful, what's very helpful. Just in hindsight here, that I'm able to kind of do in a retrospective. And the things that I thought were working against me are working for me. You know, a lot of times I think, oh, I'd really like to go see this teacher. You know, maybe if I go see him, I'll be finished. Or her, see them, I'll be finished. And couldn't handle doing it. And even in the times I tried, it all worked out terrible for me, awful. So I said, I'm not doing that again. Get all sorts of problems, you know, cars breaking down and meeting up with terrible people, just horrible. I said, whoa, what's going on here? This is not right. Something's not working out for me. So the real teachers will tell you, you have to dedicate your life to inquiry. And not only your life, but every day. And not only every day, but as much during the day as possible right now. I used to dedicate a lot more time than I do now. I'm really actually a little slack at this point. I need to tighten it up. But I am pushing pretty hard here. That's what a teacher tell you. Teacher won't say, all you need to do is come to me and you're going to get it. Mm-mm. Not unless you are right at the point, you know. Not unless you've done the inquiry, either this life or previous life. If those who truly wake up in this world, they have to be honest enough to, and they do it just seemingly easily and effortlessly and early, they have to be honest enough to say, hey, you know, this has to be the result of a tremendous amount of previous inquiry on my part. I just didn't luck into this at all. They have to say that because it's true. You cannot easily change your purpose, exchange purposes, until you are very clear that the loss of these complexes is not a real loss, that the loss is not any loss, that the loss of the sacrifice of nothing is not a sacrifice. You have to be very clear about that. And this clarity has to have permeated you to a large extent. Otherwise, there's no way you can really change purposes here, the purpose that you serve. not on a abiding basis. You might flirt with it, you know, like somebody running into the cold ocean, running back out and laughing and thinking that they got into the ocean. No, not like they're submerged in the ocean. They just put their feet into it or something. So again, inquiry is all important, and our culture is working against it in every facet. And every facet is working against it. We're so caught up in progress, trying to make progress in this world, that the idea of using our time just sitting on sitting in a chair, staring at a wall, and reading a little book, and maybe just setting it down and every day for, you know, a decade or something, people would say you're wasting your life. You're wasting your life. It used to be that people would say, "My gosh, you're spending your time in the very best way possible." In wisdom traditions, that is the case. That's what would be said. And the more you're able to focus on inquiry, the more respect is given. Not foolish respect, because one could, you know, potentially just fake it. But the more self-respect you have, because, you know, you know you're doing what's valued in that society and culture. You know, within yourself, you know. The only thing that's kept me going is my own self-respect. You know, I know I'm doing the work. So even though I'm not doing the world's work, so from the world's standards, I'm a zero. But I know I'm getting the real job done, so I have self-respect. Self-respect, I know. But it's tough, because the world standpoint, I've wasted my life entirely. And nothing. Least likely to succeed, just a nothing. And of course you cannot function if you think you're wasting your time and you're a nothing. You cannot function that way. So you have to get support along the way. You have to have actual success, feel that you're really deepening your inquiry and really getting there, and then you won't give up, because you know, even though the world doesn't realize it, you're getting the job done. Because again, the world wants to see incremental progress. Where on the spiritual path, you're aiming for the all-in-one complex is leaving all at the same time. You know, the whole thing departing, because you've changed the purpose of what you want. You've changed what you want, and therefore this complex is no longer serve that purpose and all at once. That's what you're aiming for. You're not aiming for incremental, let me shed this complex, let me shed this complex, let me shed that, let me do this. No, it's nothing like that. So we have a culture that doesn't appreciate the spiritual path, does not appreciate inquiry at all anymore. No appreciation for it, really. They only appreciate the, you know, let's fly to some country, and we've got a little, you know, some huts on the beach, and we've got a beautiful little meditation center, and you can go there for 2 weeks, and here's the program, and we're going to be eating all these macrobiotic spiritual foods, and we'll be doing some prayer and some meditation, some chanting, we'll do some fire walking, we'll have some jungle walks, we'll do this and this and this and this, and then we'll have darshan with the guru, lots of darshan, and by the end of this retreat, we all but guarantee you that you will feel liberated from your complexes, and you will be enlightened, you know, or at least you should be if you do it right. And that's pretty much what we allow right now. This culture, it only makes allowances for that and nothing more. And of course, the ego knows this won't work. So of course the ego allows it. In fact, the ego loves it. There's nothing the ego loves more than what doesn't work. That's its specialty, what doesn't work. So especially it loves the spiritual stuff that doesn't work, because that tends to distract those who might otherwise do what does work, right? So the ego loves that stuff. It says, why spend, you know, 10 years like a monk just doing intense inquiry to try and get a sense of who's telling the truth, ego or the reason, if you can just go to a retreat with a really groovy guru or guruess and just get it like that. And then if you want to go back to the world and do all the ego stuff, you can do that too. You can have it all. No problem. And then if there's a problem, just go back to another retreat and you got it again. So the ego loves that stuff. Loves it. You don't hear any voices in the world saying you need to really, your vocation has to be inquiry. Because everybody's vocation has to be inquiry, actually, if they're going to really succeed. I mean, there are places where, you know, a big percentage of the population in history was engaged in inquiry. Very simple lifestyle. There was no, you know, materiality was we didn't, there wasn't material wealth, so to speak. There was food to eat. There were some natural treatments for some sicknesses and problems. And there was some places to do inquiry. And that was it. But what more do we really need, is the question. You know, so not only was there a large percent of the population doing inquiries, they spent all their time at it. And so naturally you built up, and they actually had quite a few who were freed, quite a few. And nowadays, very, very rare, and becoming more rare. Because the demands on us to do something, just the demands to get enough money to live, are insane. I mean, a lot of those societies I'm talking about in history, those who were engaged in inquiry were not engaged in earning a living at all. Full-time inquiry. And they simply, the village people, the townspeople, the people who were not engaged in inquiry to such an extent, but were farming and herding and doing the various, you know, food production and clothes production, they would provide the food and provide a shawl, some clothing for the people. Very simple, you know, some rice, some beans, whatever, and a simple meal. And that's all that was needed. That was all that was needed. And even then, the village people, the townspeople, the people of that area would go weekly to attend inquiry with these spiritual aspirants, and they would also, you know, be clued into the importance of it. And so you'd have a positive cycle there. So now we have the reverse of that. We think, oh, who needs that? We can have it all. We can have material abundance. Problem is just trying to survive monetarily, financially, in this environment necessitates you being very successful at accumulating money, which takes a mindset of tremendous opportunism and tenacity and politicking, and you have to have some real skills to struggle in this job market to get money just to survive. So you know, maybe people say, well, I can maybe handle inquiry once a year, you know, maybe one retreat once a year is about my max. Some go to church every week, whether supposedly it's supposed to be inquiry, but it's really faded through time over the years, where it's not so much, the spirit of inquiry is not so strong there anymore. So once a week, some old-timers go like every day, some go to Mass every day, but you know, just attending Mass is not really getting into a spirit of inquiry. It's not it. You just expect the magic, you know, magic pill, the magic wafer to accomplish it. What inquiry has to accomplish, because inquiry is a choice. Inquiry leads us to see that we have to make a choice. No one can make it for us. We chose to try and separate from reality. And now we have to choose that we don't want that. We thought we wanted it. And now we say, no, I don't want that. I want to not separate from reality. And we have to see clearly the consequences of trying to separate, how they have caused us fear, you know, and made us fearful of reality, fearful of returning. And all these things have to be vetted, you know, and looked at, so they lose their potency of fear. Defenses are very fearful, and they have to lose their potency. So there is no magic pill. There is no magic pill for it at all. And yet, our culture is so much in pursuit of hedonism and human potential and materialism and desperately trying to get the money to get all the stuff, the never-ending outpouring, cornucopia of stuff. Every time you go to a store, it's all new stuff. The style's constantly changing. You know, and so we're all desperately just trying to keep up with the Joneses. And who can drop out of that into inquiry on a full-time basis? You know, well, you'd have to become a monk. And how many religious orders are there still in the world? And do they really serve inquiry anymore, is a question. Or is it just kind of a sort of a husk of what they once were, just a pale, you know, facsimile of what they may one time have been. And many of these places may be simply trying to serve social justice or charities or something, and not really engage in potent inquiry. You know, so, and doing it on your own is certainly difficult. You have to have extraordinary circumstances to accomplish this, which fortunately I have. I believe if you're determined to do it, then circumstances will somehow favor you, so you're able to do it. Problem is we've been taught the falsity that we can have it all, that we can have a robust lifestyle. I mean, the whole mantra of we can do it all, we can have it all, is ruinous. Okay, doesn't matter who says it, it's ruinous. We cannot have it all. We cannot have a robust inquiry that leads to ultimate success and at the same time be entirely engaged in the purpose of the world. It's impossible. You'd be taking one step forward, one step back your whole life. You get nowhere. You'd end up feeling like you really did waste your life entirely, and you would have. And many people are doing just that, wasting their lives because they are trying to have it all. They're trying to be superstars in all directions, which is absolute folly. Inquiry is very tough. It's a career in itself. It's the toughest career. I mean, it makes like being the CEO of, you know, some gigantic multinational look like a piece of cake. I mean, the ego would tell me, why are you wasting your time with this kind of effort if you made the same effort, you would be some ginormous superstar in the world? And the ego just couldn't understand it. The ego thought I was absolutely the worst person in the world because he says, here, you're wasting all your talents. I said, if you just bring the kind of dedication you have to inquiry into the world, just imagine what you could do. You could handle anything. And I said, yeah, I know. But I haven't yet established what the purpose that the world is serving, what it is yet. So why would I want to be serving the purpose of the world if I don't even know what it is, and I'm not sure that it's the right purpose, that I'm not even sure that it's what I want? So that's how I'd respond to the ego. But the ego just thinks that I completely wasted my time and shamefully, because I could have been, you know, quote unquote, so much more. I get a bit ahead of a, you know, information and communication empire or something, anything, just because, you know, had total stream, one-pointed dedication and towards clarity and succeeding, etc. And but again, I said, well, why would I want to do that if I'm not really sure that what this, all of that empire, what purpose it would really be serving, and would the world really be well served by that, you know, at all? So let's first get this answer, and then we'll go from there. And of course, the ego says, no, disagrees with that entirely. Of course, the ego wants you to believe in its purpose first. And then if you have any troubles later on down the line, well, you can get a quickie retreat with some guru and they'll fix you up. It's kind of like bringing your car into the shop and get a tune-up. That's how the ego sees it. If your complexes are just crushing you, the ego will say, well, okay, you need a tune-up. Go into the shop and they'll give you some new shocks and some new brakes and tune your engine up and you'll be good to go. Yeah. So, again, those of you who are suffering, you're in an excellent position. And, of course, the ego is going to fight against you, tell you, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? But the ego is lying. The ego is a born liar. It's born out of a lie. The lie is that we can change what we are. The ego is the managerial dynamic of this belief that we can change what we are. It didn't cause the belief. We did. We chose this belief. The ego arose to manage this belief so that we hold on to it, that we maintain loyalty to it, so that we can so-called try to pretend as if we can experience changing what we are and being prime creator. So it's just the ego just arose from that. So ego doesn't know anything other than that. That's the origin. The ego only knows its origin. Its origin was a lie. We can't change ourselves. Was a impossible quest. So that's all the ego knows. So the ego, it's impossible to educate the ego otherwise to the purpose that it serves. You cannot. The ego will serve the purpose of the belief that we can change what we are. It will serve that purpose. And so, of course, it's going to argue that you need to continue on serving that purpose. It will insist that that's what you really want, that existence is what you really want, that it'll give you what you really want. And of course it will not. And the voice of reason will tell you it will not. It will never do so. So you're kind of listening to the voice of reason and the ego, and you try and sort them out. And in my experience, the ego has just been absolutely horrible and terrible and vicious, and the voice of reason has always been extraordinarily patient and loving and clear and right on the money, spot on. And so, you know, and what reason has told me, I can see it's true. And what the ego has told me, I can see it's false. Well, I'm getting blasted by the sun on here, so there's nothing to do except get blasted by it. I can actually drop the gain. I don't think that's going to work. That's what we get when we drop the gain. Yeah. Wow. Drop the brightness. Well, that's just going to drop everything out. Well, that's okay. Full-on blast is fine. Here. Won't last long. So the battle between the ego and the voice of reason is a really severe battle, because the ego will never give in. The idea that somehow some guru can get your ego to give in is simply not true. Simply not true. As long as you want existence to continue, as long as you want that, the ego will be there as the managerial aspects of existence and cannot be gotten rid of. It only goes, the complexes that it manages. When all the complexes it manages goes, there's no more ego. Because the ego is simply the managerial dynamic of those complexes. It's part of that. It's all a package thing, package deal, and it goes simultaneously. But as long as you still want the purpose that existence serves, you have to have the ego. You have to have the complexes, and no guru can get rid of them for you. Only when you choose, when you're ready to have a different idea, a different desire, and a different purpose, then change what you want. You want to be part of reality. You want to be as you were created. You want to give up trying to change what you are. Give up trying to change reality. Simply to abide in reality. That's what you want. Then that's the purpose, and what arises serves that purpose, which is unconditional love. And there's no need to manage that in any way. No complexes to manage. No defenses that need managing. No ego. Unconditional love doesn't give rise to complexes, and then the need to manage those complexes or defenses. There's no need to defend anything. It's not vulnerable. You're not going to throw it away, because that's what you really want, and it knows that. So all of this has to be clarified to a certain extent, to the point where the complexes actually leave, because you decided you want something else, want something different other than this scenario that the complexes are defending for you. The complexes are just defending what you think you want. That's all. You think you want what existence seems to offer, which is nothing. You think you want that. So then all these defenses defend it for you and make it seem like you got to hang in there, and this is what you want, and you got to do this and this and this and this in order to get what you want out of it. Whereas with unconditional love, what you want is right there, apparent. There's nowhere where it's not apparent. So the loyalty is easy. You say, well, I have what I want right now. And I like that. I like having what I want right now. Because in the other purpose I was serving, I never had what I wanted right now. It was always partial and always in the future and receding into the past, slipping through my fingers into the past. And it's never what I really wanted. But now, unconditional love, it's what I want right now, right here. Wow. That's easy to be loyal to. I don't have to have a whole bunch of complexes to try to maintain a loyalty to something I don't really want or something that's very difficult. No. So this is entirely easy. That's great. Retreats can inspire inquiry. They can get you going. Or if you're lapsing, they can rev your motor back up again so you continue on. That is possible. That is possible. In some cases it might even happen. But it's not necessarily a probability. It all depends on your path. You know, every path is different. So it can be helpful. It can also lend itself to marketing abuse, you know, and the ego can easily use that. Whereas if you are doing inquiry every day on your own, it's a way of life for you. It's very tough for the ego to misuse that, because every time the ego says, well, why don't you just, you know, do this? And you say, well, that's going to interfere with my inquiry, so I don't want to do that. And the ego says, well, don't worry. We can have a spiritual retreat for you if that happens for you. So don't worry about it. And you say, no, I'm not into spiritual retreats, and I can't afford it and whatever. I don't really have any teacher. I can't find any teacher for that. So I'm going to have to keep going with inquiry every day. And the ego just says, doesn't like that. So it's better to go inquiry every day. Way better. That's the safe way. The other way is not nearly as certain or safe, and it gives the ego way too much time, because the ego will tell you, hey, you know, you can serve the ego's purpose. The ego will say that you can serve its purpose for 50 weeks out of the year, and then you get 2 weeks vacation, and that should be good enough. And then if you start saying, no, I need inquiry more, then the ego will negotiate with you and maybe give you three weeks, or really tough, maybe a month. Or if you're a real super hard case, maybe the ego will say, okay, I'll give you a year of inquiry, but you need to then give me 10 service to the ego. You know, it'll bargain. The ego is a bargainer. The ego is a bargainer. That's what it does. It bargains. The bargaining mindset is the ego. Truth doesn't bargain. Reason doesn't bargain. It knows that you have to 100%. It's either truth or lies. There's no bargaining there. So the ego, you know, if you say I want 3 years of inquiry, the ego will say that's way too much, but I'll make a bargain with you. I'll give you three, you give me the rest of your life, you know, something like that. And then we'll try to hold you to that bargain. But if you just say, no, right now I'm doing inquiry, I'm going to do as much as I can today because I've got to sort this out, and you're making it really, it's very difficult, and I know I need to really work at it hard because it's so difficult, then, you know, you just say, I'm just going to do it today, and if you want, if the retreat happens, it happens, but I'm going to continue on every day, whether it happens or not. It's not going to make any difference as far as my everydayness. The ego doesn't want this. It wants to get you off the everydayness. That's its goal. And if by sending you to a retreat, it will get you off this everydayness, it will do that. But if by going to a retreat you get inspired to continue your everydayness, then that's beneficial. That's very beneficial. So it depends on everyone's reaction to retreats, how they react to it. But by and large, it has been marketed in certain ways in this world to leave a false hope, false impression to a large extent. And I've observed many, 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 many coming to satsang and various teachers, and they expect some quick results, which just to me indicates that they're not going into it properly grounded in right effort. Because I mean if anyone really goes to satsang and they drop their complexes there, as a few did. Maybe Muji gave a testimony about that happening when he went to Punjaji finally. But he'd been on the path for a long time. He had really been on a very, very rapid path, successful path of inquiry for a long time. Very blessed life that way. So he finally reached a point where the complexes, you know, dropped away. But again, that's extremely rare. And so if someone does drop their complexes all at once and the ego all at once goes away at a satsang, very rare event. And it doesn't necessarily mean that the teacher there is extraordinary. It doesn't necessarily mean anything. It just means that someone was ready. It would have, probably would have dropped it anyway. You know, who's to say? Who's to say? I know that those who do drop it away in the presence of a guru tend to honor that guru tremendously and say, without the guru, that guru, I would not have done it. Maybe, but I would say that it may have happened anyway, because the inquiry has its own momentum, and it will succeed. It will succeed because the momentum We'll bring it to a point where finally we decide we want something different than loss, and then so it will succeed, I think, anyway. Maybe the guru speeded it up a little bit. That's possible, but a little bit. I mean, the work still has to be done prior. And maybe the guru saved a couple years, or something like that, or maybe even more. Possible. In my case, I've not come across a guru on the path, as it were, of inquiry in this world. Have not come across that I feel that, you know, by going to them, the path is going to end. I'm going to drop the complexes. Have not. But so I don't sit here saying, well, you know, might as well not even work at it, give up, because I gotta wait for the guru. No. It can happen. It can happen without a guru. It really can. If you do the work, it's going to happen, one way or the other. So don't think that you're not a fortunate one, you know. It's not true. If you do the work, you're going to be a fortunate one. If you do the inquiry, you will most certainly be the most fortunate one. You will really get free. You will really be free. You will feel entirely pristine and fresh, continuously, and feel just an endless, boundless beauty. And just absorb it and be, you know, permeated by it. You will get that. Everyone will get that eventually. So, you know, why feel sorry for anyone? There's no reason to. Because they are simply, if they're embracing loss, they're doing it because they want to be prime creator. They want to be greater than God, greater than reality. And they're just paying the price, what they think is the price they have to pay. They think they're capable of paying the price to purchase it. You cannot purchase the impossible. You cannot purchase what doesn't exist. We believe that we can purchase nothing, that we just have to suffer a lot in order to purchase it. And we don't realize that how can you purchase nothing? What price can you put on nothing? There's no mystical price at all. So you just continue on suffering. You just continue trying to get more and more loss in your life and suffering and misery and trying to purchase nothing. And there's nothing there to purchase. It's like a rich person going into into the desert and saying, I want to purchase, a lake. And they get out in the desert, and it's just absolute desolate desert. And they say, well, I guess I didn't have enough money. So they go back and they work, and come back with an additional fortune. And they put the fortune down on the desert sand and say, okay, I want to purchase a lake. And still there's no lake. And they go back and they say, well, I guess I didn't have enough money. And just do that ad nauseum. You know, there's no lake there. There's no lake. How can they purchase what isn't there, what doesn't exist? And as far as the power to change what we are, it doesn't exist. There is no such power, so we can never purchase it. We can never purchase it. So keep some many are still trying to earn enough to purchase it. Earn enough suffering, earn enough loss, earn enough loyalty, you know, somehow gain the coin, the necessary coin to purchase the power that doesn't exist. Some type of coin. Everyone's got a slightly different idea of how to purchase it. You know, is it number of deaths, number of times you've died, how severely you've died, have you been martyred, you know, have you died for others? What kind of sicknesses do you have? How much money did you get? Have a family? What type of meditation did you do? You know, on and on and on and on and on. Different ways to try to purchase what doesn't exist, what can never exist. Purchase nothing. And since no one's ever purchased it, we're kind of unsure, you know, what the coinage is. And there's all sorts of debates and arguments over it. And people will come up and they'll say, I know how to purchase it. Just follow me and I will you'll become able, you will gain the necessary wealth to purchase nothing, purchase this power of transformation to change what we are. And then people will follow them, and of course it won't work. It won't work. You can't purchase it, so it's a waste of time. You can go to, 50 retreats in your life, and you say, okay, I should be able to purchase this power of transformation now because I've gone to 50 retreats, and who else has had more than that? And you got this hope that, like, I can purchase it. There's nothing there to be purchased. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. You have to change what you want. Realize existence won't give you what you want. You cannot change what you are. So what you want is simply to be what you are. And you already are that. You just need to remember what you are. So you want to remember what you really are. And that doesn't need to be purchased because you're already that. You just need to allow the complexes that were built up to try to enable you to purchase nothing. Let them go. Let them all go. And without any of those complexes, you feel, you feel free. I mean, there's no trouble, no more trouble, no more fear. Only unconditional love is there. So these videos are like pep talks, just pep talks, saying, hang in there. It's tough, very tough, very tough. But the alternative is even worse, by far. The alternative is just horrible. Existence is just horrible. I mean, like in A Course in Miracles, Jesus, he's unsparing in his criticism and critique of existence. Just, tells it the way it really is. It's just a absolutely ghastly, heinous, horde, terrifying nightmare. And that's putting it mildly. And it's just full of despair and loneliness and destitution and depression and all sorts of complexes of every type. No mercy, and just awful. And again, it keeps doubling down, so it can get worse. It can even get worse. It really can. It's going to get worse. It really is going to get a lot worse. So, when you're on the spiritual path, even though it's very tough, realize the alternative is much worse. It's much worse. It's much worse. So you're doing the smart thing, the right thing. You're choosing what is much better. Much better. It is much better beyond the path. Much better. It's much better to spend this time struggling than it is to being spoon-fed some marketing about how you don't have to struggle. That, soon science will have a pill that will remove your feelings of that your uneasiness and troublesome, bossome feelings. Or remove all these complexes, won't bother you anymore, essentially, is what they're marketing. Get the right car and your complexes won't bother you anymore. Because as you're driving down there, everybody else has a complex, but you don't anymore because you got the right car. Yeah. You finally made it. You finally made it. You worked hard, worked smart, you were ruthless and tough, and now you've got the right car, and so you're driving and you realize, I'm okay. Everybody else has the complexes. That itself is a complex, isn't it? Everywhere in this world has just got these complexes that people are completely caught up in, impelled by. And you can tell everyone's impelled by their complexes. They're not functioning from a standpoint of reason and inquiry at all. At all. It's 100% impelled by complexes. Whatever it is. The complex of those other guys, they're on top and they're, everything's okay with them because they pushed all the complexes onto me. So I'm going to find a way to topple them, and then I'm going to be the one that's without complexes, and then they're going to be the ones with the complexes. Like that, you know, is relative type of thing. Who's on top? And so it's all shifting and changing these complexes, and everyone's functioning in the grip of these complexes. They don't even realize it. The world doesn't even realize they're in the grip of these complexes, that literally these complexes are playing the body like a puppet. The complexes are the puppeteer. The ego is the ultimate puppeteer, but it configures these complexes, and then these complexes then guide our activity and our actions. These people who commit these atrocities, they're in the severe grip of a certain type of complex or complexes that are literally impelling their behavior. But, you know, we're all in the grip of complexes. The world itself is a complex. It's in the grip. The universe is in the grip of complexes. And these complexes simply continue to try and strengthen themselves. So the behavior that you see, that's all comes from complexes. It comes from the ego and the complexes. And existence has to be that way. It can't be any other way. Like thinking there's some way for existence to continue on and for us to want it and to be loyal to it and yet not be functioning through these complexes is not possible. It's not possible. We have to change what we want. Otherwise, we truly will be simply automatons, kind of being guided or misguided by these complexes. That's all there is to it. Nobody is acting out of free will in this world, really. They're in the grip of these complexes, and these complexes are distracting them, and what they do is complexes build up more complexes. That's what they do. Just increase, 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 increase. And then you die. But a spirit of inquiry is not going to do harm in this world, because the spirit of inquiry will just say, well, no, wait a minute, I'm not trying to do anything. I'm just trying to determine what purpose the world is serving and whether there's another purpose I want to serve other than this one. And do I have a choice? I'm just trying to find that out. That's all. What's the purpose of the world? Is there another purpose I could serve? And do I have the choice to choose between the two of them? And so you're just thinking that is your consideration. So when the complexes try to impel you to do something, which they will try, no question, in complexes, all the troubles in the world, everything is happening because the complexes are impelling people to do it, and people are not strong enough. They're not in a spirit of inquiry. So they cannot resist. They just do it. And they wonder afterwards, what in the world did I do? You know, really. You got to... From the standpoint of truth and reality, you have to have forgiveness for people. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That means that they were simply in the grip of these complexes, egoic complexes, and they're unable to halt the momentum of action. And afterwards, you know, they may have had severe remorse, saying, my gosh, what did I do? They say that Judas went and hanged himself out of severe remorse. So, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's forgiveness. So when you have those people doing terrible things in this world, they're in the grip of some very, very severe complexes that are just impelling them to this. They were not brought up in the proper spirit of inquiry. They didn't have that spiritual inquiry going in their lives, and not enough to say no to these complexes. And complexes are trying to impel us all the time. There's the old angel and devil, angel on one shoulder, devil on the other. As you have the voice of reason, the spirit, the grace of God, the Holy Spirit on one shoulder, and you've got the ego and the complexes on the other shoulder, and the ego is trying to impel you into what it wants, the complexes want you to do, and the Holy Spirit's trying to say, no, 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 just let that complex, let that thought go by, don't act on that. So you do have to make an effort to not act on these complexes, but in a society that we have now, it's becoming more and more difficult, which is why you have these very unfortunate tragedies happen. Every day there's some shooting, which means somebody was overpowered by complexes that impelled them to do this, where they could have chosen inquiry. They could have said, no, wait a minute, before I do anything like that at all, let me inquire into the purpose of existence, and let me first determine, is this what I really want? Do I really want to do this? I haven't decided, and I'm not going to do anything until I look at this more carefully. That prevents people from being victimized by these complexes, and I'm sure that those who carry out these terrible atrocities at some level just feel utter dismay. How could they let themselves be utilized by these complexes to do such a thing? And so there needs to be, at some level, there needs to be compassion for those who do these things, because they're really are incredibly dismayed with the fact that they allowed themselves to be utilized in this way, you know. They don't really want to. Heck no, nobody does. That's crazy. Nobody would want to put themselves in that sort of position of a complete pariah, you know. It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy all around. So the wisdom traditions have forgiveness. As Jesus pointed out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So in other words, forgiveness has to be there, because the egoic complexes are constantly trying to get us to act in certain ways, and many of those ways are very bad. We would, you know, very, very egoic oriented, and even though those complexes are there, we can't get rid of the complexes. We can say, no, I'm not going to act that way. See, that's a different thing. I'm not going to act that way because I have to determine who's the boss, who's the authority, what's right, what's the right purpose, what do I want to serve, and do I have a choice first? Before I put you in any authority over my life, I want to determine it. So you might just say, look, nobody has authority over my life to tell me what I have to do. I want to first determine what the right thing to do is, and I haven't determined it yet. So, you know, you may not be a person of action, really. I'm not a person of action at all. I say, no, I'm not going to act this way because I'm not sure. I'm not going to support this thing or this thing because I'm not sure yet. So if the world really wants to have less of these tragic, tragic, shocking events, it has to turn towards the path of inquiry. There is no other way. And of course, the world thinks it's so smart. Problem with us is we think we believe our own marketing, and we think we're so smart that we can come up with a way, some other way other than inquiry, a pill, as it were. We've got all these scientists, you know, we've spent trillions of dollars supporting all this research, and we've got them feverishly working on, you know, bioengineering, try to develop an organism, and just, you know, whatever we can come up with. Everything but satsang, everything but inquiry, everything but inquiry. Okay. And you can even have these people up on stage, religious teachers of all different persuasions, and go do a song and dance, you know, for all sorts of songs and dances. And they'll do everything but get into inquiry. Everything but that. Experts at avoiding it, but avoiding it in a, you know, kind of comfortable way for everybody. Everybody kind of thinks, yeah, that's kind of a cool way to avoid it. I kind of like that. That's what they do. And you come away feeling, that was pretty entertaining. But then you feel like, you know what, I really didn't really get anything out of it. I didn't really get any depth, really. I don't really feel like I have really any true inquiry going on here. And that's not right. When you hear inquiry, it's different. It's not the song and dance, you know. It's not someone screaming at you, "Be healed," and you know, it's not that circus. It's not that circus. It's not that circus atmosphere. Everyone, you know, they want healing, but they want some specific ailment to be healed instead of letting all ailments just go at one time, at once. All ailments come from the egoic complexes of existence. And again, those complexes have to arise in existence. It's impossible that they not arise. And, you know, you can maybe think you're beating them back, but they'll then come right back. Cannot have existence. The purpose that existence serves, you cannot have existence other than how it is. And any effort, we're just kidding ourselves, fooling ourselves, overestimating our capacities, thinking that we are so smart we can change reality, the way the reality functions. We think we can change it. That's overestimating. That's called, what do you call it, arrogance. Spiritual arrogance is really at the root of the problem. We just we think that we can do it. We're not sure, though. We've got to pay attention to that not sure, because that's more accurate, right, than say, "I'm not sure, I don't really know, so let me find out what's going on here," instead of just arrogantly going forward and saying, "Yeah, you know, I can find a way to get rid of those egoic complexes and still, you know, call this home, call this vast scenario of loss home, and maintain the purpose of being able to change reality and change what we are and become prime creator, etc. Maintain all that and yet not have the complexes. We think we can do it, and so we support all this research. You know, how can we knock out this and knock out that? New illnesses coming up all the time. Let's have a run for this, a walk for this. We got to knock this out. We got to defeat this, etc." Just imagine if we spent all that time and money and effort and focus on inquiry. You know what would happen? We'd literally all be complex-free and dwelling in unconditional love, and that being translated into reality, and the world would vanish, be no more. Wouldn't be any more world. Wouldn't be any more sickness. Wouldn't be any more vulnerability. Wouldn't be any more people in a world. Wouldn't be any of that. We already would have been long, long finished with it. Long ago. If we just took the time, the effort, the money, the focus, the dedication, the perseverance that we spend in trying to fix the world, fix various parts that keep breaking, and turn that all into towards inquiry, poof, we'd already be in dwelling in unconditional love. Flawless refreshment, refreshing feeling. Beauty, surrounded by infinite beauty, endless beauty. That would already have happened. If someone would come into the world and have some kind of illness, and they would, you know what, if they were to say to everyone, "You know what, don't worry about it. Spend your time on inquiry. Don't spend your energy trying to research what you can do, you know, for me. Spend it on inquiry instead." People used to do that. They'd say, "No, don't let this deflect your purpose of inquiry. Stay with it." And then in their illness, they would use that themselves as a motivation for inquiry. And everything would be different. People used to have that attitude. Is, you know, if you fall ill, fall sick, etc., nobody panicked, nobody freaked out. And the one who was sick would have a very spiritual attitude toward it and saying, "I'm going to continue my inquiry, you continue yours. If there's a little bit of comfort I can have, that's fine. But let's keep our faith in the goal. Let's not take our eyes off the prize because of this." That used to be that way. Now, if anyone has an illness, everybody freaks out and says, we got to do everything we can possibly do to make sure that we stamp out this illness. We find out the genetic origins of it. We find out what kind of therapy is going to work. And we're going to leave no stone unturned until we find out what caused this and wipe it out. We'll spend any amount of money, any amount of time, any amount of effort, got to wipe it out. Not realizing that the very effort to do this is generating massive more complexes. Terrible complexes are being generated from that type of focus. It's making things even worse. So how off the track are we? We're a train wreck. This civilization is a train wreck. Complete, total train wreck. It's not just off the track, it's a train wreck. And yet, again, that's no excuse not to continue your inquiry, because you most certainly can get to the point where you see clear enough and you say, ah, okay, I'm at the point now where I'm able to then allow the release of these complexes to go there, to release them and let them see them dwindle into nothing, into just a shell. No more significance. I'm at that point. I can do that now. And you will do it. So it's still doable. It's still doable. And it's either that or continue on generating even worse complexes. But I'm telling you, the complexes that I am seeing in the world now, of those who've come into the world more recently, and what's being generated currently in the world, the complexes are just severe. Frightening. Scares me. It even scares me. I mean, that... what scares me is simply seeing the complexes that the world is caught up in now. The leaders of the world and the followers of these leaders and the complexes that the people have now. And the whole way it's belief in half-truths. Severe, severe complex. Scary. Really scary, because these complexes will impel them into very bad behavior. See, we think we're in control. Some of the guru would say, well, who's this I that's supposed to be in control? Meaning, it's really the complexes that are in control. There's no I that's in control. There's a spirit, which is ultimately in control. You have to realize that. But that will comes from spirit. It doesn't come from any persona or I. Persona is complexes. And these complexes try to get the body to act the way they want it to act. And they can get the body to act very, very badly. Very, very badly, very viciously. And we've seen that throughout history on this planet. Those are simply the play of complexes. Doing their thing. Using bodies as cannon fodder. And the complexes in the world now are exceedingly, exceedingly nasty. Chillingly so. So, I mean, that just in itself is enough for me to say, wow, come on, gotta get this done. Get her done. Because again, the complexes impel behavior unless one is grounded in very strong tradition of inquiry and personal inquiry in their own lives. Only that has the power to stand up to the complexes and say, no. Not now. I have to wait a while. You know, if the complex is saying, you must attack your enemies, they're your enemies, attack, attack, attack. And you just say, hey, maybe yes, maybe no, but not now. Because I'm doing inquiry and I haven't sorted it out yet, so you'll have to wait. That's why I always tell the ego complex, I say, you know, you gotta wait. Like the sickness tries to get a hold of me, and I just say, nah, I'm not going to be sick right now, you're going to have to wait. So maybe later. We'll see, but not right now. And I've numerous illnesses have tried to grip me, numerous, severe, and these complexes tried to kill me many times. And I just said, I would just, what I do is I go into this state of determination and dedication to inquiry, and I realize inquiry is what I'm going to do, and that's what I want to do, and this illness cannot interfere with that. And then I just tell this complex, this illness, I just say, you must depart from me because I'm not going to entertain you now. I don't say forever, I just say, not now. Not right now. And, you know, I don't say, well, 3 years, 4 years, I don't make a bargain or deal. I just say, not now, because I got something else I got to do. And that works. That works. If you want to maintain your health to some extent, you can do that. You can do it, because that's what I've done. I can be coming down with something very bad and in one day gone entirely if I pay attention and get back to that adamant commitment to inquiry. Then I can just talk to this complex and just with my will just face up to it and face it down, stare it down and say, no, not now. I've got important business to take care of, and you cannot be bothering me right now. Really adamant, you know, with it. And, you know, it backs off. You know, maybe cursing, but it's fearful, you know, it's fear driven. So you can stand up to these complexes. In some, you know, the idea of healing someone else is someone who has that attitude can cause a complex in someone else to back away, but that's temporary, it'll come back. With vengeance, you know. So the healing is temporary. It's when you do it for yourself, where you know how to do it for yourself. That's important. You give someone a fish, you feed them for a day, you teach them how to fish, you feed them for a lifetime. So you cannot depend on healers, because all the healers are doing are saying to that complex, you know, this, you must back off now, right now. But it's temporary. You say, just for right now, back off. And later, the complex will come back and say, okay, this is later. This isn't now. Now I'm going to get you. And then the person will say, oh, I'm getting sick again. I'm getting sick again. And then they'll go rushing to the healer again. And again and again and again. And eventually the healer gets a healing complex or something, and they succumb to that. Seen that happen. So it's way better for you to learn how to stand up to those complexes through commitment to inquiry, because you will say, I've got something that's so important that I simply cannot be bothered right now. You simply have to, I insist, you must not bother me now. I insist. There's no compromise on this, no bargaining. Right now, you cannot have access to this body at all. Okay, this body might cannot have access to it. Must back off. And then it recedes, it backs off. But the overall, the one thing I've not been able to get back off is fatigue, because the overall aggregate of all these complexes, they're all there causing extreme burden. So I can get, you know, they're all still there. It's just when one gets really aggressive and tries to, you know, harm the body, I'm able to push it back, get a little space. But they're still there, so I know they can come again and again and again. You can't get rid of them until you actually, again, change the purpose of what you really want. Whereas you don't want to try and change what you are. Then they all go, they all leave. You don't even have to ask them to leave. You don't even have to push them away. They're just gonna, like a spider, just, you know, spider goes quickly. Spider, you know, some spiders can be very quick. They see them, pew, they're gone. So the complexes, they will just leave on their own accord because they're no longer relevant at all, and they got nothing to do, and they, pew, so don't have to push them away. Anything other than that, you're just pushing them away temporarily. Which again can be done, and usually has to be done when you're on the path of inquiry, because the complexes will try to stop you. They'll try to destroy you, definitely. They'll either try to impel you into some kind of self-destructive behavior, or they will hit you with some severe illness and try to kill you, kill the body. So, you know, you need to learn to realize just this very simple fact. You're in control. You're choosing inquiry. That's what you're dedicated to, and it's the most important thing. It's more important than this complex, no matter what the complex thinks. It's numero uno, and you're not going to have it interfered with in any way. This illness will not interfere with it. It must back off, and you just stand up to it. Serious. You know, it's not a joking matter. You're not asking it. You're telling it. You're just saying, this is what I am now, inquiry, and you're not part of that. And I won't allow you to be part of that, and it backs off. You know, so you probably have to be able to do that. I had to do it many, many times. Many times. You know, and sometimes I had to really, really focus on it very intensely. We're running up a good satsang here, aren't we? You never know what you're going to hear as you go along, right? I had no idea. I have no idea what I'm going to say. So it's just whatever suddenly becomes clear, then I just say, oh, okay, this is clear. Let me share this with you. Wow. Okay. Well, it is. That's probably enough. It's a good place to stop. It leaves some ground to have another video. And I recorded this video in higher definition. I don't know how it's going to come across. It's kind of been kind of jerky like this, that the movement isn't as smooth because of a higher bandwidth that I'm using. So we changed internet service provider. We have higher bandwidth uploading and downloading. So it's possible to upload it in higher resolution, but it kind of made some of the movements not smooth. So I don't know how it's going to look, but anyway, it's the sharing verbally that is very important. Sharing of ideas, clarifications, etc. That's important, and the video is just kind of it's just a backdrop to feel comfortable with. So okay. Cool down a little bit here. Coming to the end of this video. I can even take my headphones off. That's a good way to cool down. We'll just cool down here. It's been a good one. It's been a very good one. Way to spend the evening. Remember, the Olympics are coming up. A lot of distraction. A ton of distraction. Had a bad time. Don't want to get distracted that way. So hopefully this video will fire you up. Fire you up so you realize, hey, success really is possible. Let me not vacate my effort here. Let me continue to push it.